talked about the kingdom for 40 days. And Jesus said, it's not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath placed in his power, but ye shall receive power. Okay, that was future tense. And he told them to wait at Jerusalem for the promise of the Father, and they did. They waited until the day of Pentecost, and the power came down. Now, friend, I believe we have several generations that have lost the meaning of fullness of power in the church, and a lot of it is due to false doctrine. A lot of it is due to abuse, which is actually blaspheming the Holy Ghost of God. That is, claiming that the Spirit of God does things which are contrary to what the Scripture teaches that God's Spirit does, and desiring to have the Spirit's power for selfish reasons rather than for the reasons that God gives power. And so let me ask a question by way of review. Why is it that God gives the fullness of power to an individual? Why would a person have God's power, the power of the Holy Spirit, flowing out of them? Why would that happen on an individual basis? What would be God's purpose in it?
To preach
the gospel. And Acts is a textbook for that. Every time the Holy Spirit supernaturally filled individuals, supernatural things happened, and the end result was that multitudes came to Jesus Christ. On the day of Pentecost, when they spoke glossa, or languages, they spoke in tongues, which the Parthians, the Medes, the Persians, the Elamites, the Arabians, the Cretes, people from all around the world, when those individuals heard, you can go ahead and go on into Sunday school, guys. Mrs. Price is already in there. If you're teens, you can come right on in here. When that happened, what instantly happened was that the gospel was preached in those languages. It wasn't just babbling. It was preaching in a language. And the end result was that people came to Christ by the droves. The same individuals, it's interesting, Peter's conclusion to his sermon was, you know, you're the ones that crucified, whom ye crucified. Him hath God raised from the dead. And the end result was that they received the very Jesus that they had been, that they had really danced around the cross blaspheming just a few short days, or just a month before, really a month and a half before. That's incredible, isn't it, what happens when the power of the Holy Ghost comes on someone? Now, believer, you and I do not serve a God who was alive then and is less alive now. God is able to do amazing things. The problem is a lot of it is that our expectation of what we want God to do oftentimes has selfish fulfillments. In other words, sometimes I think, and again, I don't know the hearts of people, and you know, I said I think. Did you notice that? I don't know every person. But I think that sometimes individuals want to be Spirit-filled, so people say, look at them, they're Spirit-filled, look how spiritual they are. A Spirit-filled person is spiritual. But we don't desire to be Spirit-filled so that people can be impressed by the things that we've done or by the fact that we've got God's Spirit in. Listen, my friend, if God fills you with His power, you're not impressive. He is. And so many times I think we get it back where we're mistaken about what God ought to do. But we kind of finished up our series in the last couple weeks, and we talked about how to actually be Spirit-filled. I wish you could have been here for that. We do have it on recording, and I think eventually, if it isn't already, it'll be up on YouTube. So you can watch it online if you'd like to watch that series. But this week I want to get practical. I want to have a rubber meets the road. Before we do that, though, how's Sandy doing?
No, she's doing good.
She is. Okay.
She was just afraid of maybe getting somebody.
Oh, sure, yeah. She should. Sandy had surgery on, now I can't, it's Tuesday, right? Tuesday. But everything's going just like that. Okay, good. Praise the Lord. What would I answer to prayer? We're really rejoicing about that Wednesday, that all the prayers that were answered in that surgery. So, okay, good for the update. Well, I want to get practical today. And I would like to actually talk about something relevant and talk about being Spirit-filled in it. Let's do it. Let's do it today. Let's let you teach the lesson. We're in Matthew chapter 5, and I want to read a couple verses to set us in the frame of thought. If you'll look with me down to verse 43, and we'll read to the end of the chapter. Ye have heard that it hath been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. Well, that isn't too bad, is it? It isn't too difficult. It's pretty natural, actually. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. Notice this next phrase, for he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love them which love you, what reward have ye? Do not even the publicans the same? And if ye salute your brethren only, what do ye more than others? Do not even the publicans so? The next verse is one that, even in its context, is a little bit, a little overwhelming. Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. That's a high standard, isn't it? Could I say to you today that any believer who is filled with the Spirit will not have behavior that contradicts the commands of our Lord Jesus? Does that make sense? In other words, I think that as Christians, we would want to say, wouldn't we, that not only is the Spirit of God living in me, but the Spirit of God is controlling me? Now, when the Spirit of God controls us, it can happen a lot of ways, can it not? I've experienced different levels, different kinds of Spirit filling. For instance, I've had the Spirit of God in just a very... Sometimes it's not such a still, small voice. Sometimes say, you better watch out. You ever had the Spirit of God do that? You're about to say something, you're about to do something, and the Spirit of God convicts you. And I submit to that. And I shut my mouth, usually, is the way usually the way that plays out, is I don't say something. Maybe I would have said, come on up and sit down if you guys want to. There's plenty of seats. So I don't say something. Or I stop my action, or I draw back from an action that I've started. Has anybody here ever had that happen? You started something, and then the Spirit said, this is not right, and you stopped. Praise the Lord for that. That's Spirit control. That's being controlled by the Spirit. That's being filled by the Spirit. That's one way of it. I've also had it more overt. Many is the time that I have had the privilege of having a chance to witness to somebody and having the Spirit of God take over. I've shared the gospel with people and really been honest about the fact that, you know what? This isn't about man's wisdom. This isn't about me giving correct answers or me being persuasive or laying out an argument. This really is about the fact that this person needs to be saved and they need God to speak to them. And I've had God speak through me. I've had Him use me. Now, you know, you don't want to be out of left field or whatever with it, you know. But it's amazing sometimes the Spirit of God will give you wisdom. You ever been given wisdom? You know, if somebody keeps talking and they want to argue about something and all of a sudden the Spirit of God tells you that isn't the argument. It has nothing to do with that. Here's the deal. He just puts his finger on something and gives you scripture for it. And when you ever had scripture, like you've memorized the scripture, but it's not on the top of your head. You haven't been meditating on it. You haven't been thinking. When I'm meditating on scripture, it comes out naturally. But, you know, all of a sudden the Holy Spirit gives you the verse of the scripture and shares it with you and shows it to you. You ever had the Spirit of God just make you smarter than you are? I have. I've said things and thought, boy, that was good. Wasn't me. Evidently. So that can be being filled with the Spirit. But Christian, I want to say to you today that on a very basic level, we as believers will not be Spirit-filled if we contradict the commands of Jesus on how we're to live. In other words, don't misunderstand me, I'm not saying that we have to control the flesh and then we'll be filled with the Spirit. My friend, without being Spirit-filled, you'll never control the flesh. And that's the reality. And there's a fine balance there between one and the other. In other words, sometimes we get so caught up into do, or don't do. That's what we focus on. Well, you know what? Don't curse. Don't this, don't that, don't this, don't that, do this, go to church, go to whatever. And all of a sudden it becomes a work of the flesh instead of a work of the Spirit. It isn't because we have a desire in us, because we have a love of God, because we have a burden and a hatred for sin, and because the Spirit of God in us helps us to desire and to have victory. It's because we've learned to series of behaviors. Boy, that's a sure way to burn out as a Christian. You show me somebody that's tired, exhausted, burnt out, and sick of serving Jesus. That's somebody that's trying to serve God with the flesh and not the Spirit. It'll just wear you out. It'll just exhaust you. But friend, practically speaking, we could say, couldn't we, that a person who contradicts what the Scripture says is behavior for our believers is not Spirit-filled? Yes or no? Yes or no? Okay, let's get contemporary. Let's talk about, and Andrew hates it when I use the word contemporary. We're all pretty contemporary here, though, folks. I'm taking things back, man. If words abused or misused, I'm still going to use it. So we're contemporary here this morning, which means we're alive right now and we're living today. Okay, so hopefully you're contemporary with me as well. This passage of Scripture talks about loving neighbors and hating enemies. What were the major, especially in Florida, major news events in the last 7 or 8 days?
The killing in Orlando.
Okay, the Orlando shooting in Orlando. And what kind of a place was that, where the killing was at?
It was a LGBT bar.
A what?
LGBT bar.
Homosexual bar.
Yeah, it was basically probably a pretty wicked place. What other news events last week?
Alligator.
Also Orlando. Alligator. Yeah, an alligator killed a baby. Killed a 2-year-old.
And it was also another killing in Orlando.
The senior was killed also.
Oh, yeah.
The teen contestant was
okay.
Killed.
Yeah, so a lot of killing last week.
Yeah.
You know what's really interesting to me is watching Christians respond to that. How many of you, when somebody comes on U.S. soil and wages war against us, how many of you makes your blood boil just a little bit?
Oh, yeah.
How many of you think that it's likely that we're going to have another major terrorist attack again soon? How many of you think it should have happened probably in Wilton Manors instead of Orlando? It was just an ignorant terrorist, right?
Yeah.
I mean, truthfully, if you want to attack that group of people, it should have been here, not Orlando, factually. How many of you think it's a problem? Anybody feel frustrated by the leadership in our country?
Oh, yeah.
Anybody feel like that we don't have any good options right now to change that leadership in our country? Yeah. And how many of it just makes you downright mad? I mean, I'm mad enough I want to do something, you know what I'm saying? I feel like, you know, you want to act out, you want to respond, to do something. Hi, Sheila. The question is, how do we respond in this matter in a way that's Spirit-filled? And I'd like it to be a group project here today. I'd like to talk about it. Let's talk about, first of all, let's talk about this family who had a 2-year-old and they were at a Disney resort. And their 2-year-old was killed by an alligator. It's probably an easier scenario for most of us, isn't it? Matthew chapter 5, verse 44 says, "You've heard that hath been said of old time, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy." Now, it wasn't said in the Scripture to hate your enemy. But that was an old saying. Hey, love your neighbor, hate your enemy. In other words, make sure your hate's in the right place. Make sure your love's in the right place, right? Now, it's unnatural to love your enemy. Can we get that? Do we get that? Okay. But Jesus said to His disciples, and we are disciples, are we not?
Yeah.
Jesus said to His disciples, "But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you." You know, I greatly appreciated last week. Now, as an organization, not a purpose person, but I really appreciated Chick-fil-A's response last Sunday. Yes, did you read about what Chick-fil-A did in Orlando last Sunday?
They opened on Sunday.
They opened on Sunday. In other words, it was an ox in the ditch kind of a situation as far as Chick-fil-A was concerned. There literally was a street lined up with gurneys of people trying to get into a hospital and their first responders, and Chick-fil-A said, "These people need to eat." And so they opened up their store and fed chicken sandwiches to everybody. And the people they fed sandwiches to were the people that boycotted them a couple years ago. Tried to wreck their business a couple years ago. Remember this one before Kathy died? And he just said, "Hey, I support the family." And they said, "You know, we're going to put you out of business. We're not eating any more waffle fries." And, you know, and really pushed back against Chick-fil-A because they were a family values, because they're, you know, there are a lot of Christians involved in that company. Let me ask you a question. We don't know, and I'm not an alarmist. I'm not an alarmist, but supposing somebody walked in the door of this church to kill people. Let's just talk about it, shall we? And let's talk about it in balance. Okay, somebody comes in these doors to kill people. Who's the first person they'll probably want to kill?
You.
Yeah, most likely me. Probably not for anything personal. Well, it might be personal. I don't know. Tony might have put up something on YouTube. Who knows? I'm going to tell Tony did it. It wasn't me, man.
I'm sure I got a lot more enemies.
I hope so. All right, but they walk in this room, they want to kill me. Now let me ask you a question, friend or enemy?
Enemy.
Okay, it's in it, right? Somebody wants to kill you, they're not your friend probably, right? Okay, so let's make sure we're at least clear thinking here. Okay, let me ask you a question then. What should we do? Somebody comes in this door to kill me, what should we do? What? I've heard a lot of different things from different preachers about this. This is actually debatable. There's debate about this.
Neutralize the threat.
Charlie says neutralize the threat. Well, I agree with him. You know? In other words, say, stop, or something like that. You don't think that'll work, Stacy?
I think we'd better hurl a couple of chairs.
Hurl chairs?
Oh, yeah. They're unhookable. We could probably hurl a few, maybe.
I think I'm going to make a trap door right here and just hit a button. Y'all handle this, would you? I'm being serious, though. What is something like, you know, something, you know, sometimes as Christians, we never think about what we do in a scenario. We don't think about what we do, and we don't act like we're filled with the Spirit when we do it. Supposing that happened, somebody came in this door, and they came in here to shoot me, and Joel shot them. Supposing that happened. He's in the best place to do it, besides me. Oh, okay, so Joel said, "You're on your own, bastard." Okay, supposing they came in the door and I shot them. Supposing that happened. Do you think the news media would come here afterward?
Yeah. You'd be in trouble.
And what do you think? What do you think would be the concern of the world?
Guns.
Your gun.
Gun.
Well, yeah. You know, why? What's a preacher doing with a gun, right? For one thing, that would be a question, wouldn't it? I mean, would it be politicized? Would it immediately become a political issue?
Yeah.
What if they say to Joel when he's coming out, "Can I talk to you for a minute? Can I ask you a few questions?" He says, "Yeah." Let me ask you a question. Why do you think that person went in there? Well, because they're a bunch of no good. And he started, you know, talking about Islam and maybe just quoted the hadiths a little bit, talked about some of the things that Muhammad said, you know. What if he said, you know, Islam teaches pedophilia, which it does. What if he said, what if he just cut loose and just said, you know what, this problem that we have right now is not a problem of our preacher shooting people, but the problem is that people are coming into churches and coming into places to kill, and the reason they kill is because, you know, we're infidels in their mind because we're not. You know, and you could go through, you could just look. How many of y'all have taken the time to read at least portions of the Quran and the Hadiths? Has anybody here ever done that? Joel has?
Yeah.
It's pretty amazing, isn't it?
It's actually, yeah, these.
It's X-rated, actually. It's perverse. It really is.
It's not an ISIS doctrine, it's a Muslim doctrine.
Yeah, it's a Muslim doctrine. So supposing we discuss that, I'm just telling you something. If you were to read those things, you'd realize this is not religion. This is just perversion. It really is. It really is very, very perverted.
You didn't say the shooter was a Muslim, though.
What's that?
You didn't say the shooter was a Muslim.
He probably wouldn't be anything else.
He was a Muslim.
Maybe he would. Yeah, okay. So, yeah, he's going, ah, la, 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 la. Charlie could yell it for us if you'd like. But anyway, but supposing that happened, let me ask you a question, friend. If that happened, if somebody came here and they either shot me or I shot them, do you think that it would be because that it rains on the just as well as the unjust? Here's the question. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, he said, it raineth on the just as well as the unjust. In other words, the reason that person has breath to come in here and try to take my breath is because God gave it to him. And that's an interesting consideration, isn't it? I'm not a pacifist. I don't take what the Scripture talks about when it talks about reaching people for Jesus and apply that to nations and say that a nation. You know, I'll just tell you something else. I'm not a pacifist. It would be one thing for me to take something that is wrong to me. It's a whole other thing for me to stand by and let someone else wrong someone else. You understand the difference? I had something really odd happen at my house about a month ago. I was working on my car, one of my TDIs, and I was running some tests on with my laptop. Actually, I was flashing a different program on the computer on it. So while I was doing that, my wife came out, and the dumpsters were empty in the front yard, and they were empty, and there's a man walking down our street, and he walked straight at her and was just staring at her like in a real odd way. Well, I'm sitting in the car, and I'm on the street facing him. He doesn't see me in the car, and he walks right up to her, and he's really looking her up and down. And so she said, good morning, and he's still staring at her. And she said, stop staring at me, to this guy. He's a pervert. And so she knew I was in the car. He didn't know I was in the car. And so she wasn't afraid. She didn't run from him or anything like that. But she said, stop staring at me. Well, he started just saying some really perverse things. Okay, let me ask you a question. I'm her husband. Should I put my head down?
No.
No, I got out of the car. And I looked ugly. And he didn't know I was there, so I had a little bit of an element of surprise. Okay, now, here's what I didn't want. I didn't want a headline that says Baptist preacher. You know, starts with, you know, headlines that start with Baptist preacher, not good headlines, right? Okay. Something else I didn't want. I didn't want to hurt anybody. Honestly, I didn't want to hurt anybody. That's really the truth. Although I felt like hurting somebody, you got to have your brain engaged. Okay, so what did I tell the guy? I said, hey, move on. I told him he couldn't walk on our street anymore. It wasn't a free country. I told him something like that, too. Okay. He did. He moved on. He yelled taunts. He ran away and taunted, you know, while he ran. Okay. Now, do you think that if somebody's messing with my wife, do you think I should stand up and say something?
Sure.
Absolutely. I do. You think that's, you know, do you think that flies in the face of Scripture? Mm-hmm. I don't think so. Now, I'll tell you what I won't tell you what I would like to have done. I didn't do anything. I could have. I'm not a helpless individual. I haven't been helpless in a long, long time. I'm more helpless than I ever have in my life. I'm weaker than I've ever been. And it's been a long time since I've ever had an altercation with somebody. But the fact of the matter is that I wasn't afraid of that guy. But I didn't do anything to him. You know why? Because I wanted to be Spirit-filled. In other words, it wasn't about, well, I'm going to teach this guy a lesson he'll never forget. If I'd done that, that would have been the flesh. That would have been about me. And my thought was, you know something, I need to stop this. I need to make sure my wife is not vulnerable in a bad situation. I need to make sure it doesn't happen again. But I don't want to harm anyone. You see the difference, though? There's a little bit of a difference, isn't there? You know, I was close enough. When I stepped out of the car, he's walking right by me. You know, I totally had the drop on him. I mean, he'd been on the ground before he even knew I was there. And that isn't the point. Point is you want to walk in the Spirit, not be controlled by the lust of the flesh. Okay, so was I blunt with him? Was I forthright? Did I tell him exactly? You know, I told him a couple of things. You know, I told him he wasn't allowed to walk on my street. and he's not allowed to walk on my street anymore. He can't come on my street. You say, Pastor, there's laws that say he can come on your street. No, if he comes on my street, I don't know what'll happen. Maybe police will arrest him or something. He's not allowed. I hope he never comes back. I told him, I said, don't come on our street anymore. Why? Because he can't be on my street. My wife walks on our street. He can't walk on the same street as her. He denied himself that privilege. Okay. Somebody comes in this door, and they come here to kill. Are they a friend or an enemy?
Enemy,
right? So how should we respond as believers? You ever think it through? You ever think all the way through? What would I do if that happened? Charlie said neutralize the threat. What if, I mean, if they're smart and they come in, they're going to come in firing, right? So this guy in Orlando was one of the best shooters as far as, I've always wondered about mass shootings. Anybody that's a shooter knows, you know, you take an AR-15, it's got 30 rounds. You may put 2 rounds into each person, but you ought to have 15 dead people. Like that. I mean, just like that. You know, you could clear this room in seconds. You know, people think they could pull a gun out. You could clear this room before it was done. Before anybody could pull a gun or whatever. Well, if that happened and someone survived, how would we respond? And I'll tell you how we ought to respond, friend. You tell me. What if it happened in the homosexual church in Wilton Manors? Let me ask that question. What if somebody walked in that church and shot them up? And then the news came outside of our church and said, I'd like you guys to comment on what happened down there. How should we respond? It's an interesting question, isn't it? Is it blasphemy to have a church organized around the concept of sexual perversion? Is that blasphemous? Is that blaspheme the Holy Spirit? Is it blaspheme God? Is it wicked?
Yeah.
I think it's more wicked than a wicked nightclub, don't you? In a lot of ways, to try to drag the name of Jesus Christ and claim that this is God that does this. I think it's a little worse, isn't it? How would you respond? What?
Compassion.
Okay, with compassion, how do you do that?
It's a terrible thing.
It's a terrible thing, isn't it? Listen, friend, how many of you all remember very, very clearly do you remember just last week a guy was prosecuted for Auschwitz? He was one of the work camp guys. He was, what, 90, 94? Yeah, so it would have been 70 years ago this year, or 2 years, I guess a couple years ago. So anyway, regardless that he worked in Auschwitz. If that were to happen, we were to respond with compassion, how would we do it? What?
We
had to preach Jesus. Listen, Christian, I'm as frustrated as I can be with the state of affairs in our country. I'm frustrated that the leadership in our country won't even call evil evil and good good. Is that frustrating to you?
Yes.
Does it bother? I mean, it really bothers you, doesn't it? Does it make you feel like, you know, do you feel a mixture of betrayed, vulnerable? I feel betrayed and vulnerable. If I were going to describe my feelings, I'd say I feel betrayed and vulnerable. And you know what I should do about it? Do you know what to do about it?
You need to pray for this country
because it's as bad as I used.
The first thing you should do is pray. How many of you last week on Monday did more than just pray, God be with the people in Orlando? How many of y'all prayed, Lord be with the people in Orlando? I think most of us probably did, right? How many of you prayed and said, God, show me what I should do about Orlando? That's a difference, isn't it? It's a lot different, isn't it? It's one thing to say, God, be with that city. I mean, isn't there an aspect of us that feels like, man, this could be judgment? I know. One of the things I prayed last week was that God would silence Christians who are going to claim that they need God's what God's doing in it, right? In other words, there's God judging. You know, you could have said something like, don't put this on YouTube. And that is an overtly perverted organization that works to destroy your children. I just hate Disney because of it. I've never gone to any of the Disney parks before. I've had a lot of opportunities to do it, and I just never have. I'm not saying, I've never made this statement, I never will, but I'm not interested. I just don't like them. That's Disney that I hate. I don't hate anybody in Disney. I don't hate any people. And I don't want anybody to be killed. You know what happened when Osama bin Laden got shot? It made me sick. I almost threw up. You know why? Because he's in hell. And I wouldn't wish hell on my enemy. I wouldn't wish hell on a person who'd murder me. You say, I want to take your life. I don't want my life to be taken, and I have some good reasons to not allow it. But I wouldn't wish hell on a person that would take my life. I have eternal life. You know what a Christian response ought to be to wickedness? To pray and say, God, give me wisdom to know how to preach the gospel in this. Help me to know how. Listen, friend, you know what's going on in the Middle East right now? I'll tell you, there's a lot going on you don't know about. What's going on in the Middle East right now is that there are Christians there preaching the gospel in a way it's never been preached before. And while they are wiping out organizations that are, quote, Christian, but probably not Christian because of conversion, because of receiving Christ as their Savior, while they're killing Christians, more Muslims are getting saved than have ever been saved in hundreds of years in the Middle East. And that's a fact. And why is that? Because, my friend, there's no power like the power of the gospel. And you know something I feel in this country? I feel as though I have been betrayed, and I feel as though I'm vulnerable. This past week, here's what happened. This past week, a place where no one's allowed to have weapons to defend themselves, which I'm not arguing that there should be weapons in a nightclub. I'm not making an argument. I don't think there should be nightclubs, you know. But a place where people weren't allowed to have weapons to defend themselves had somebody go in there and kill someone. And our president's immediate response was, we need to stop people from having guns. As though the guy couldn't have just blown the place up or, you know, driven a tank through there or manufactured guns or...
Nice.
What?
He had explosives on
him. Yeah, he did have explosives on him. As though the guns were the issue. In other words, it was entirely politicized. And so people that are concerned for their safety are told, you know what, we'd like to take away your ability to defend yourself. And that makes you feel kind of extra vulnerable, doesn't it? I mean, it just kind of makes you feel like, well, that doesn't make any sense at all. Somebody may kill me, so what you're going to do is make sure I don't have a gun to kill them, to neutralize them. Anyway, I don't want to talk about guns. I want to get in a gun debate. I've told people in our church all the time, I exercise my Second Amendment right, and if our country were to take away my Second Amendment right, I'd give them my firearms. I just let them have them. I let them have everything. You have all of them. I can tell you what I'd do after that, but I'd give full disclosure. I'd give them all my ammunition, all my weapons. They could have all of them. It's not a God-given right to be an American. Did you know that? God's not an American. When Paul said to submit yourself to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, he was talking about the Roman government. That was a pretty bad government, if you want to ask me. And if you want to ask Paul, it's the government that, you know, put him to death for being a Christian. Okay, so a little perspective, Christian, on that. Being God's not an American, and owning guns isn't a God-given right. It's a good thing to be an American, and it's one of the things that makes our country what it is. But if our country's to the place where that can just be taken from us, our country's not the country that we know as America. It's not the same. Now, I don't want to get controversial about that. I want to get into, again, that's it's not just political, but it's American, not biblical, not necessarily God's view scripturally. But what probably bothers me more than anything else is how people who are frustrated do nothing about it. Let me ask you a practical question. Do you have a plan to do something about the Orlando issue, the massacre in Orlando? Do you plan on doing anything about it? Does it bother you? When things bother you, should you usually do something? Well, what's the plan? Well, yeah, we're powerless. That's exactly right. Why?
No response is correct.
Is it because Obama won't let us do anything? See, I don't think some of you understand the question. Are there people in Orlando that need to be ministered to right now?
Yes.
Are there people in Orlando right now that might be at a time and place in life that they could be ministered to more easily than they could at any other time?
Oh, yes.
So what's the plan?
We need to go witness them.
You know, I think the first thing we ought to do as believers, we ought to fall on our face and pray and say, oh God, what should I do? And most of us just talk. We talk about what's wrong. We talk about what should be done. But we don't get on our face and pray until we have an answer from God about what we ought to do. This last week, this little two-year-old boy, that was tragic, wasn't it? It's just too bad, the little boy that was eaten by the alligator, killed by the alligator. It was too bad. And I have dear friends that are debating on social media about whether, you know, alligators have the right to be there or not. I saw the picture of the beach, and it's a beach, and there's a hotel right, you know, from here to the back wall from it. And I'll just be honest with you. I don't trust the judgment of somebody that thinks that people and alligators belong in the same location, you know. And I don't trust the judgment of someone who thinks that, you know, well, alligators were here first, and so we got to just let them be there, you know, when we have two-year-olds walking on the sand. I don't trust the judgment of somebody that thinks along those lines, do you? Honestly, it's not that hard to take alligators and remove them. And if I've been places where alligators are allowed to be, there's plenty of them. They're going to be all right. The alligator population's way up. It's out of control. It's so far up. And so when somebody tells me, well, you know, they were there first and you just can't. No, when you have a man-made lake like that one, you can say, we made the lake for men. Gators don't get to go here. And yet people are debating about whether or not you ought to have alligators where two-year-olds are. And what bothers me about that is just how crazy we are. How nuts we are. And I'm talking about Christians. People that ought to have, you know, biblical thinking. They ought to understand that animals and people aren't the same. God made man in His image. I understand being good stewards. I understand things like that. But for crying out loud, you don't have to have alligators in a lake next to a hotel with an inviting-looking beach on it that toddlers are walking on. Now, I know, now they're going to fence it and keep the toddlers out of there. That's fine, you know, whatever. But here's what struck me about that story last week. They said, you know, the parents are just glad that they've recovered the body. And I thought, what a terrible thing. And they said, so when they went to tell them they had a body, they took a Catholic priest along with them because the family was Catholic. And how many Christians were struck to pray about getting the gospel to a family whose child is in heaven? Is that two-year-old in heaven?
Yes.
Yes, he is. How do we know that? David said when his child was lost that he was going to be in heaven. He was going to see him again. But you know the problem in that family? Mom and dad aren't going to see that baby again if they don't make it to heaven. They need to hear the gospel. They need to hear it preached with compassion, with love. Have you prayed that someone would share the gospel with them? What if there was one person in the world that God wanted to share the gospel with that family? And what if that person were you? How would you ever know? Do you think that it might be in a church our size, maybe God would have somebody to pen a compassionate, loving letter with a $100 bill in it? Not that a $100 bill is going to make any difference, but it might get their attention that a stranger sent them something or whatever else. You think that somebody might be able to do something that would just get them to listen to what you have to say? Maybe there's a Christian somewhere that's lost a child. That could say, I know what it is to lose a child, and I know what it is to be guaranteed that I'll see him again. Something bothered me last week. The Spirit of God troubled me. I wondered whether or not you knew outside of what the church says, or you knew outside of what religion says, whether or not you're guaranteed you'll see your child again. And I think a Spirit-filled believer would pray and say, God, what should I do? How should I respond? You know, was it American Idol? Is that what the singer was?
Yeah, it was on one of those shows.
I don't watch any of them.
The Voice.
Okay, The Voice. I don't, whatever they are.
It's a...
Anyway, this young person was shot. Do you think that anybody around that person's troubled? You know, there might be someone that has access to them that if you were to talk to them, you could do something, or something could be said, or something could be done. I'm just telling you something, friend. Spirit-filled Christians act after they pray. Okay, so what do we pray when we want to be filled with the Spirit of God? What do we pray? What? Pray for wisdom, yeah. Okay, according to our class, if we want to be filled with the Spirit, what do we pray for? Charlie, answer.
Spirit.
Yeah, we pray for the Spirit. Jesus said in the Lord's Prayer, He said, if ye then being evil know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Heavenly Father give the Spirit unto them that ask Him? And you think if you prayed and said, God, I'm frustrated. God, I just feel betrayed. But God, more than anything else, the greatest tragedy would be if something like this happens and people don't hear the gospel. That's the greatest tragedy. Hell's the tragedy, my friend. Hell's the tragedy. The tragedy isn't whether a nightclub full of people who are sexual perverts get shot up. It's where they go. It's not whether or not a city is fearful and devastated. It's who they go to. And as Christians, we sit around and gripe and bemoan and complain about we don't like Donald Trump and we don't like Hillary and we don't. But we're the people that have all the answers. And I would submit to you that a church that isn't doing something is not filled with the Spirit. A church that doesn't say, what ought I to do? So many times as Christians, we're just like the armchair quarterbacks. We talk about what somebody should have done. And it never even approaches our thinking about whether or not the gospel should have been preached, or whether the gospel should now be preached. I'll just tell you something, that's all you can do. It's all you can do. You want to figure out what to do about our country today, my friend? Don't vote red, don't vote blue. Get on your knees and say, God, how am I going to share the gospel? I'm not telling you not to vote today. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying. All I'm saying is I don't care who you vote for. It's not going to change anything. And you know that was true in the last election, and the one before that, and the one before that, and the one before that, and any election there's ever been. Because what changes people is righteousness. The Bible says righteousness exalted the nation, but sin is the reproach of any people. And we got a serious lack of righteousness, and we want to call it political. I think a righteous people preach the gospel, don't you? Yeah. I think a Spirit-filled people preach the gospel, don't you? Christian, can I ask you to do something? Would you pray about those three events this week? Would you commit to the Lord? Not to me. You don't need to come tell me. This is what God showed me. But would you pray about them this week? And say, God, show me what to do. For 7 days, I'm not talking about, 24-7, but for 7 days, would you just go before the Lord and say, God, what should I do? I wouldn't be surprised if God told you. Would you? kind of a God do you serve? What does it mean to be Spirit-filled? That's the question. I want to get practical about Spirit-filled living, Christian. Spirit-filled Christians do. They live out what it means to be filled with the Spirit. They don't live it out in the four walls of the church auditorium. They live it out in their lives, in the world, and they make a difference as a result. Let's thank God for what we learned this morning. Father, I pray that you'd help us to apply what we've learned to our hearts and our lives and live for Jesus as a result. God, I pray that you would impact our minds and our hearts about this matter of being Spirit-filled and how to deal with the times in which we live. God, you haven't put us in the future generation or the past generation. We're here today. And God, we're going to answer to you for how we respond in our life to the circumstances in our day. We're going to answer for whether or not the Great Commission is fulfilled in our day. And I pray that you would help us to be able to stand before you and have you say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." Lord, be with our service as we worship in a few minutes. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.